You are watching Channel Y. Channel Y, a South Asian Canadian channel.
Hi, this is Priyanka Chopra and you are watching Channel Y.
The biggest South Asian media group, Y Media.
Y Media.
Y Media has newspaper, midweek, radio, South Asian Pulse.
Hi, I'm Amitabh Bachchan and you're listening to South Asian Pulse.
Hi, this is Amir Khan and you're listening to South Asian Pulse.
Ab har din sune GTA ka number one radio station FM 91.9 dopehar 12 se sham 6 baje tak.
Television. You are watching Channel Y.
Channel Y. You are
Prime Minister, welcome.
It's a pleasure to be back.
Online, SouthAsianDaily.com. The biggest South Asian media group, Y Media.
This part of the program is brought to you by Midweek Newspaper, published every Tuesday.
Welcome everyone. You're watching Channel Y. I am your host, Shelley Senny. And today I have a very special guest with me in the studio. I have with me Minister of Small Business and Export Promotion, Minister Mariang. Welcome, Minister.
Shelley, it's so great to be here. It's so great to be back here at YTV.
The pleasure is ours. Well, you know what? I want to begin our conversation with the very latest announcement that you made. $19 million of investment in Ontario from the federal government when it comes to women entrepreneurship.
That's right. I was in front of literally hundreds of female entrepreneurs today. $19 million for women entrepreneurs here in Ontario. What's it to help them do? It's to invest directly in them, to help them start their business, to help them grow their business, but also to create ecosystems of support so that we could deal with some of the barriers that exist for women entrepreneurs. We hear often that women entrepreneurs get challenges finding access to capital or being a part of those business networks or getting that mentorship that they need. That's what this investment's going to do. It's going to help them grow.
And you have been instrumental when it comes to women entrepreneurship, giving them the right platform, giving them the right voice, and giving them the right funding. So we have that. But you know what? Some people are questioning the timing of this announcement also. Few weeks to go, and we have the fall election. They're saying, is it a gift right before the elections?
No, not at all. We were elected in 2015 with a plan. This is very much a part of the plan. The very first women's entrepreneurship strategy. It's a $2 billion strategy that I am very humbled to lead. And why do we have a women's entrepreneurship strategy to begin with? Well, 99% of all Canadian businesses are small and medium-sized businesses. Only 16% are women-owned and women-led. In the face of a study that has been done by the McKinsey Global Institute, we can add up to $150 billion to the Canadian economy. So this is very much work that has been taking place. Our government listened to what we need to do, how we make these investments into female entrepreneurs. The Prime Minister gave me a mandate to double the number of female entrepreneurs by 2025. We've been hard at work. I've been across the country making announcements very similar to the one today. Today just happens to be the one that we are doing here in Ontario, but I have been doing them from, you know, from the east coast of Canada to the west coast of Canada, you know, to the north, and this is putting to work the $2 billion strategy that we are making for women entrepreneurs.
You know, you mentioned jobs, you mentioned small businesses, and you mentioned Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. So my next two questions are actually linked to these three topics. Coming first to Prime Minister Trudeau. We know what the Ethics Commission report said on the SNC-Lavalin affair. Although after the report came out, Prime Minister Trudeau said that he was saving jobs. You are Minister of Small Businesses and Export Promotion. Was he really saving the jobs, or what the opposition is saying, is that true?
Well, as the Prime Minister of the country, he needs to look out for all interests and do it in such a way that really ensures that we are always standing up for Canadians. My job as the Minister of Small Business and Export Promotion, it's about helping Canadian businesses start up, scale up, and access new markets, and making it easier for businesses to do business. It's really important for us to create jobs in this country. Jobs and a healthy economy is what fuels our ability to have the kind of social environment and the kind of Canadian society that we all enjoy and that we want to continue to enjoy. So, 1 million jobs have been created since 2015. We have the lowest lowest unemployment rate that we have seen in the last 40 years. In my portfolio, have cut small business taxes from 11 to 9%, making it one of the lowest in the world. This is real progress for Canadians, and we're going to keep doing this work, and because the work isn't done yet, and we want to keep doing this work because it's going to keep fueling a Canadian and a Canada that I believe that Canadians want to continue to have.
Absolutely. Well, we definitely want to keep growing. Now, speaking of small businesses, mm-hmm. and yes, one of the lowest taxes mm-hmm. in the world, 9%, that happened under you. But, you know, there's one concern that came across when I was talking to people who actually deal with small businesses. Mm-hmm. They were like, their counterparts in U.S., they have relatively easier access when it comes to funding because of the lending system over there, which isn't available as smoothly in Canada when you compare it to U.S. What are we doing over that?
So we're doing a lot of things. I mean, I've met with about 5,000 businesses in my time as minister. I've been a minister for just a little over a year, and I hear that from businesses. So we've done a number of things. For young entrepreneurs, a program like Futurepreneur, it's about giving our young entrepreneurs access to that very first capital. And it isn't just the capital that's actually really important. It's the fact that in that program, they also get 2 years of mentorship so that they get the guidance along the way as they are growing their business. The Business Development Bank of Canada is Canada's only bank for entrepreneurs, and it's a crown corporation of the Government of Canada. They are putting capital out there to help entrepreneurs, businesses start or to grow. Again, it comes with advisory service, and there, one of the things that I'm really proud of, linked to the Women's Entrepreneurship Strategy, is a $200 million fund, which is the largest of its kind to fuel and propel women in technology in particular. And that's just one example. The Canada Business, Business Loans Act, which helps to provide some assurances to Canada's banks to help it make it easier for them to be able to provide loans to their small businesses. So we're trying to make sure that we are providing capital and access to capital in as easy a way as possible. There are a lot of growing companies, innovative startup entrepreneurs who are looking for equity financing. So not debt financing and loans, but equity. And we have just put $450 million into the venture capital system, which was not doing well before. And now we have private sector that is partnering with government, also raising capital, equity financing, so they can take a chance on those very innovative ideas and startup companies that's growing here and that we are investing in Canada.
All right, you know, one of the questions also, and these are coming from people who are small business owners here, yeah. and I told them, you know, I will be mm-hmm. having a conversation with the minister, so yeah. do you have questions? So one of the small mm-hmm. business owners who is actually an immigrant here, mm-hmm. so he asked me, when I came here, I had the idea of starting my own business, mm-hmm. but I didn't know where to begin from, mm-hmm. who to ask, what are the options? Okay, I know people have been telling me there are options for small businesses, mm-hmm. but what are the options? What door to knock? How do we bridge this gap for newcomers?
You know, that is a great question. So we are helping newcomers. We are helping Indigenous women. We are helping women entrepreneurs and young entrepreneurs because an inclusive economy, an inclusive society is what's actually going to help not only our economy, but our society. But that very point I heard literally all across the country. So I will say to people, check out the Canada Business app. It's an app. You download it like the way you download every other app off of the Apple Store or Google Play, but it's our attempt to be able to be responsive to the businesses that I heard, especially small businesses and entrepreneurs, newcomer entrepreneurs. Where do you start? So it's really great because if you go onto the Canada Business app, it also speaks to you like the way that you and I are speaking. Start my business, protect my ideas, import or export, file my taxes, finance my business. So it's intended to be user-friendly. This is the federal government, so we're big, but this is our attempt to be sure that we are taking all, what we do as close as we can in a user-friendly way to people.
All right, so through that app, mm-hmm. they will be getting all the information they need mm-hmm. to start their small business?
Yes.
And to be able to run it successfully? I mean, of course, it's their hard work, but if and when a need arises, they can find their answers there?
Well, because in the app, there's actually a little chat box that you can actually ask a question. So if it's not there, you can ask a question. And you know why I know this works? Because as we launched it, I tried it myself.
Okay.
As a person, you know, and not as the minister. And it came back, and I thought, oh, this is interesting. Now, I would also say that this is the beginning, so we are looking for feedback so that we can improve upon this first app. But it is a beta, and we have put it out there. But it is directly as a result of what I've been hearing, directly from small businesses.
All right, what was the app again?
Canada Business.
There you go. So all the small business owners who are watching this right now, this application is for you. Download it right now, and all your questions are going to be answered. But of course, it's your hard work that you put in your business. Coming back to our conversation about small business. Mm-hmm. Small businesses, they create the maximum employment. Mm-hmm. On one hand, that technology is helping them. Mm-hmm. But the flip side, again, which a lot of small business owners have felt, that they are feeling the burden of technology on their business. Say, for example, I'm a grocery owner. Mm-hmm. I run a small store. People mm-hmm. have been coming to me for years. But today, they have the option of a bigger store who can deliver them at home because there is an application provided. Yesterday, I had 4 cars. I had my own taxi business. But now, you have Uber. You have Lyft. What are we doing to change that or to train these people better?
Yeah, you know what? Great questions. So I'll start where you ended, which is how do you train people better? Like, so we were hearing this from people as well, from businesses, but also from people. And also looking into the future, because that's what governments have to do, right? How do we make sure that we are ready for the future? And so in this last budget, we put out the Canada Training app, Canada Training Program, or Canada Training Benefit. And what is that? It's a benefit that is there for workers. You take it over a 4-year period, you get a week a year, and you get $1,000 in that period. The idea here is to make sure that for workers to be able to get upskilled and continuously to get skill, it also is wonderful for the employer because it means that you're going to get employees that are constantly updating their skills. And this is sort of now, we're going to put this in systematically so that workers and employers actually benefit from this. So that's one thing. The other thing around, technology is, I meet businesses all the time. So the high-tech business is important to me, but you know what? But so is the restaurant, so is the flower store, so is that little corner store that is so important in a neighborhood. Earlier I said we cut taxes from 11% to 9%. A business saves about $7,500. I have heard from many businesses. What they want to do is they want to take the savings that they're getting that year and they want to reinvest in their business because I want to digitize it a little bit. So if you are a retail store and you want to change and digitize your business and put a point of sale system, you could do that with that savings, right? We've also made some changes to the tax rules that allow you, it's called accelerated capital cost allowance. So it basically encourages you to invest. We did this in response to businesses. They said, give us an incentive. So if they're going to invest in equipment or an asset in their business, they can write off a larger share of it in the year that they acquire it. So overall, as I said, my job is also about making it easier for businesses to do business so that they can be competitive. So those are a couple of things that we're doing. A lot more, but those are just a couple of the highlights.
All right. Yeah. Well, speaking of high-tech technology, yeah. You represent Markham and people. I live in Markham. Do we see Markham becoming the next Silicon Valley of the world?
So Markham already is very much a high-tech capital. You have major technology companies that have been there. So, you know, technology companies that are world, that are known, right? The IBMs, the AMDs, and GM, for example, their new autonomous vehicle research center has been located in Markham. And they are doing all the work for driverless vehicles, right? So it really is already a hub of, you know, of high-tech. But here's what I would say about it isn't just Markham. I mean, I represent Markham. You're from Markham, and of course, I love Markham. But what this is about is building out a Canadian capability, right? So Markham is part of the Advanced Manufacturing Supercluster, which is all throughout Southern Ontario, because we have such strengths here. We have such great post-secondary institutions. We have great large companies that want to innovate, that want to become a supply chain and an innovative partner, a research partner to those who are doing the research, those startup companies that are already developing products or technologies, and really putting them in a cluster approach so that those synergies are collaborating with each other with one thing in mind: growing our economy, growing these wonderful jobs, and for Canadian companies to really, you know, take the stage and take the leadership that I know we are capable of doing, because we're, that's what we're investing in.
That's what you're investing in. But at the same time, although we call it a hub, the entire Southern Ontario belt, but at the same time, because you mentioned companies like IBM and AMD, mm-hmm. Speaking of AMD and Intel, they don't have their headquarters here. In fact, their functioning over here is very limited to certain operations. Yeah. And what the people who have been working there have been telling me, in the near future, though, they don't even feel like expanding. Mm-hmm. What do we do with that? Because these are big names we are talking about.
You're absolutely right, which is why we need to build out our Canadian companies, those that are small companies, and giving them the capabilities to become medium-sized companies, or those companies where we are growing out so that they become that next unicorn on the one hand, which is what my colleague Minister Baines is working on. But what am I working on? I'll give you an example. Recently, I announced the creation of an integrated market here in Canada, and it is in one vertical, which is in health and in bioscience. It's a great strength that we have here in Canada. We have a world-class system here in Canada. And what is it? It provides institutions to early adopt Canadian technologies that are created in Canadian SMEs or in leading-edge startups. And what does it mean? It means that they're going to, so imagine you're a big institution, the Trillium Health Network, for example, that is here, Health Partners that's here. They are actually the lead institution, working with a whole number of institutions here in Ontario, and then there's another set that is for Western Canada as well. So it's, all of it is called the Can Health Network. So imagine that you are a small, you're a company, you're a developing a medical device. You want to be able to sell into and iterate and work with an institution so that you can sell it into that institution. They're going to work with you. And they're going to work with your Canadian company. And if you become sale ready and you sell into one, you now can sell into the entire network. That is about scaling up. That is about creating Canadian capability of early adoption, iterating, and scaling up what is being developed here in Canada. Shopify today, or yesterday in the news, is now valued higher than BCE.
Yes.
It is a technology success story, a Canadian headquartered success story. And if you were talking to the, you know, to their CEO, as I was, we were on stage recently, he said the best place to start up, start a company and to grow and to scale is in Canada. And I couldn't agree with him more. That's the work we're doing to help our Canadian companies so that we are going to grow more companies. They're going to be headquartered in Canada. They are going to create jobs. And we're going to help that investment all the way along.
All right. Well, that's actually very good to know. Mm-hmm. And I know all the people who are listening to us right now, watching us, not just the small business owners, but people who are actually mm-hmm. in the field, in those fields of technology, related fields, they are quite content to listen to that. But I think one thing that concerns everyone is the international relations that Canada is mm-hmm. having right now with the rest of the world, mm-hmm. especially with US mm-hmm. and with China. Mm-hmm. Because export promotions also, that's mm-hmm. one of your department.
Yes.
And that definitely, when the trade relations are sour, it affects the small businesses as well. Where do we stand now?
Sure. The U.S. is an important trading partner. They are our number one trading partner. They're a friend, they're a neighbor, and they will always be important. And of course, you know, my colleague, the foreign minister, has successfully negotiated the new NAFTA between Canada, U.S., and Mexico. China is our second largest trading partner, and they, too, are also important. But let me tell you about trade promotion, or export promotion. So Canada today has 15 trade agreements around the world. And these include trade agreements like the new NAFTA, but they also include trade agreements with the European Union through CETA, or many of the Pacific Rim countries like Australia, Singapore, Japan, Malaysia. So 12 Pacific Rim countries through CPTPP. We also have bilateral agreements with countries like South Korea, Israel, the Ukraine, Chile. What does it actually mean? What do all these trade agreements mean right now for Canadian businesses? Access to 1.5 billion customers in the global marketplace. 1.5 billion. But here's the interesting thing. So you would say 99% of Canadian businesses are small and medium-sized businesses. They have access to 60% of the world's economy through these trade agreements. 1.5 billion customers. That's a lot of customers. Only 12% export today. And of that 12%, 70% is going to the U.S. So the opportunity for diversification and trade diversification is enormous, which is why this government, under the leadership of Prime Minister Trudeau, made a decision and an investment for trade diversification. So it's a $1.1 billion strategy to diversify our trade, making sure that we're helping our Canadian companies become more export ready so that they could take advantage of these customers in the global marketplace. Just a couple of days ago, I made an announcement on the East Coast, but I made one here in Toronto. I've made one in Montreal, in Western Canada. On a program that's called the Trade Accelerator Program, actually also called TAP. And what is TAP? TAP works directly with businesses, with entrepreneurs, so that they can become export ready. They can grow into the global marketplace. Why did we invest $15 million in the TAP program? Because in the 3 years that it was operated here in Toronto, the success that we saw were actual results. So a little over 500 companies went through it. 75% of those companies actually penetrated a international market through exporting. Over 20% actually received new business, new revenue directly from exporting, growing their business through exporting. 47% of those companies hired new staff. So to me, that is where we want to make sure we are supporting our Canadian small businesses so that they are getting export ready. But we also have the Canadian Trade Commission Service or a program like Can Export. It helps businesses go abroad to do their first trade show or to explore some market, do some of that research that they need to look at where they want to expand. And when you go there, the Canadian Trade Commissioner Service, I call them Canada's best sales force in the world. They operate in 161 offices around the world. They are ready to help Canadian companies grow into that marketplace because they have the contacts, they know how to navigate those local markets, help you with the introductions, and basically at the end of the day support our Canadian businesses. So we are very much on our way of being able to take advantage of the existing customers that already are available to Canadian businesses through those many, many trade agreements that we already have. Yes, we need to continue to pay attention to the other trade activity around the world because of course it matters to Canadian businesses, but we're not gonna let that stop us. We're going to just keep working with Canadian businesses so that we can help them be as ready as they can so that they can grow.
Well, you know what? That is exactly what Mr. PM said when he was in Montreal, that Canada is not going to stop.
No.
But speaking of China, what do you have to say? And also because Secretary of State, U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo was here and he met with Chrystia Freeland and Prime Minister Trudeau. And he said that U.S. is diligently working to release the detained Canadian citizens. Do we have an update on that? And what's your reaction on that?
Well, our priority always is on Canadians. And yes, we are concerned that we have two Canadians that are detained, and we are going to work very hard. My colleague, the foreign minister, the prime minister, and, you know, and indeed with, you know, others who are willing to, you know, work with us, because getting our Canadians home is always our top priority. And we are going to, we're going to keep working hard on that.
And because we're talking of China, what do you have to say about the pro-democracy protests that have been going on in Hong Kong? And I say that because that's your home country as well, you, right? Recently, what really happened was a British consulate employee has been missing since August 8th. And just yesterday, China said, well, we have detained him because he violated regulations and he is on a 15-day detention because of the regulation violation. But Hong Kong was not informed. Your comment on that?
Well, you know, to where you started, you know, we share some similar values, Canada, with you know, those in Hong Kong, which is the freedom to express yourself and the freedom to assemble, and the people of Hong Kong have that freedom. What we have also said is that we have 300,000 Canadians that are in Hong Kong, so of course we are paying attention, and of course we are concerned because we are concerned for our Canadians who are not in Hong Kong, absolutely everywhere around the world. We are always concerned for our Canadians, and that's what we need to be doing. So we would encourage that both sides, you know, that both sides continue to keep a dialogue open, and we don't condone violence. We encourage for peace. the people of Hong Kong obviously have something to say, and we share, as I said, the ability to have freedom of speech and freedom of assembly, but it must be done in a way without violence, and it must be done in a way that is peaceful. And to encourage dialogue is how you get to a resolution. So we want to see that, and we will always, be mindful of the Canadians and be always have on our minds the work that we need to do for Canadians here at home, but Canadians indeed all around the world.
Well, you know what? To all our viewers right now, I really want to tell them, and from you, I really want to get a message out there. What one can do in this country with hard work and dedication. Well, your parents came here with their hard work, they established their own business, and you're here representing the people, mm-hmm. you're here in the House of Commons. Mm-hmm. What's your message to all the youngsters who are watching you right now? What you can do?
Well, I would say get involved. There is such opportunity to get involved. You know, volunteer if you are interested in the political process at all levels of government, and irrespective of where your own political leanings might be, getting involved I think is the best way to to get a feel for what it might be like to be in civic office, right? And it is to dream big. Nothing is in your way here in Canada. And I think when my parents came to Canada, I was 7 when we immigrated to Canada, and they came, they didn't speak English. I learned English in Canada as well. And I don't think that they thought at the time that this was what it was going to be. But what I knew for a fact was that my parents said, look, we came to Canada because we want to provide a better life for us, but also for you. And while you're here, take advantage of the opportunities. Open yourself and give things a try. Even if you fail, give it a try. And that's what I would say to young people today. The opportunities are there, and don't be scared about it. You would be surprised if someone knocked on my door, how many people might say yes more than they will say no, because they will want to see you succeed. And I would just say, give it a try, get involved, and you just don't know what's going to happen. And dare to dream, and it's okay to fail in that course, because you'll get up and you'll keep doing it.
That's an incredible message. It's okay to fail, but dare to dream. Well, you know what? It's an election year. We are a few weeks away from 21st October, and everybody is pretty much, they've made up their mind. And right now, every move matters. So all that is happening, leaving aside that, what is going to be your message to the people that if you come back, what will change, or what new can happen?
I think that what we have done so far, creating jobs and having a good economy, helping the middle class and those working hard to join it. I mean, 800,000 people have been lifted out of poverty since 2015. That, and a third of those are children. Having the lowest unemployment that we have seen in 40 years. 9 out of 10 families are doing better. Seniors are, have more affordability for those that are the most vulnerable. This is the beginning. The work is not yet done. And I'm excited to go back. I haven't stopped, quite honestly, but to continue to talk to the people who I represent, to share with them the progress that we have made together, to continue to listen to people, to be sure that we are working as hard as we can for them and for their children and their grandchildren, like on the environment. And we'll ask for a mandate to come back to keep doing this work and more. But it is a Canada that we, that we need to continue to build, and we have done some really impactful work. And I'm looking forward to getting out there, back into Markham Thornhill, talking to the voters and sharing our progress, but also listening to what we need to be doing for them in after October the 21st. If they bring us back.
Oh, definitely. All right. Well, Minister Mary Ang, thank you so much for speaking to us and giving your time to us, and also, you know, to all the messages that you have given to the young viewers out there. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you so much, Shelley. I'm so glad to do this, and I want to do it again.
we would love to have you again. Yeah, yeah. Good, good.
All right, well, the special interview is over, but you know the news isn't. For all the latest news and updates, you stay tuned with Channel Y and with all the platforms of Y Media. Thanks for watching.